just go ahead and then we'll maybe wait like one more minute for other people to join, but I don't run on PSAS time, so.
I run PSAS time all the time.
I am on time.
I guess, should we start screen sharing at least?
Yeah, would you like me to start off with Adam?
Should we, I think we should both be up or just you to start maybe?
I think just having one screen for now would probably be less confusing.
Cool. So Hunter's made some rocket-inspired parts just to keep with the PSAS theme.
It's perfect. Let's use it.
I guess just let me know when we're gonna, or when we feel like it's ready to start.
I think you can go ahead and start. We'll probably have people join late, but that's fine. That's just how it is.
Gotcha. Let me close this so that we don't have random noise. There we go. All right. Howdy. My name is Hunter. I've worked with Adam previously at a 3D printing job, and we both use 3D modeling a lot to do various projects. And apparently, Onshape is really good for working collaboratively as a group, and that's something that Adam and I have not done a lot of, but it's something that we can both try and like get everybody who's a part of this meeting a little more acquainted with, as far as some of the good practices as far as managing data and making sure that nobody is stepping on each other's toes and that no data is being lost by people, yeah, stepping on each other's toes. So
credit to Joe for introducing me to Onshape quite a while back, and also to Hunter for picking it up before and letting me know that it's very relevant to other people as well. That didn't quite make sense, but yeah.
No, I think one of the things that I really enjoy about Onshape is that it's kind of an all-in-one platform that doesn't require you to have multiple packages installed, and you don't have to constantly be updating anything. Like, I don't necessarily need to sell all of you on using Onshape, but it's something that I've been working with for the last 5 years. In fact, for a while, I was in communication with one of the original developers of Onshape, because they were located in Boston, or at least were at the time. And I gave them some feedback as far as like my experience teaching elementary school kids on how to do parametric 3D design. And so it's like a really flexible platform that when you start to bring in some of the collaborative modeling tools can be like really powerful. So hopefully the path that Adam and I set you off on today will help really like expand your abilities as a group to 3D model together. So I think one of the main things that I've been asked to kind of talk about is best practices when working with other people in a 3D modeling space. And I don't know exactly what you guys have been doing up until now, so if everything that I'm saying is sounding redundant, just let me know and I can move on from there. But one of the things that I find works best when you're working with people, first and foremost, is to label everything. Whenever you create a new document in Onshape, it will, or a new part studio like I'm going to do right now, it's labeled Part Studio 1. And these tabs down here, like, they could be anything. So always making sure that you're renaming your workspace to reflect what you're planning on doing in that workspace is super important. So yeah, I could just call this test space. And then anything that I create in that space, I'm also going to want to label as well. So just making sure that whenever I click on something or create something new, I'm going to rename it to, yeah, whatever. It's like, this is going to be cube. Nope, that's CB. C-U-B-E. Great. So just as long as everything that you have over in your parts list here and also your parts or your workspace tabs down here, as long as those are labeled, that'll really help you. Another thing that really helps as far as making sure that everybody knows what's going on and where is the ability to create folders. And you would do so by clicking the little plus icon down here, same as you would to create an assembly or a drawing or a new part studio, but they have a folder option here. And so what I've done is I've gone and created different folders for the different kind of sections of this hypothetical rocket that we're going to build. So I've got it broken down into main fuselage, connectors, nose, and business end. And I've created this test part here in what we're going to call like the main directory. So I wouldn't want anything to necessarily be floating around in here because I want it to be categorized. So first and foremost, putting that into the applicable directory would be helpful. Like I could put this in main fuselage, even though I don't know what a cube would necessarily be doing in that area. But let's go and take a look at some of the parts that we've created for this. So first and foremost, we've created a fuselage tube. It's 8 inches in diameter, 8 inches tall. It's really not much to say about that. We also have a camera bay. Adam informs me that this would be pretty drag inducing. I'm sure that's absolutely true. But this was just created in about 10 minutes, so I'm not going to worry about the drag performance on this too much. One of the other things that I've done is I've actually imported somebody else's model that they made of a 360-degree camera, apparently the Insta360 1X, I guess. You can find parametric 3D models like this all over the internet, such as GrabCAD. That's an excellent website for finding things that people have already made. So you don't have to necessarily go through and build everything yourself. I know that McMaster Car also has virtually all of their products digitized. You probably already know this, but it can be really helpful if you're just needing to throw a piece of hardware in and you don't necessarily model it yourself. So I was able to pull this in here as a, what was this originally? I think it was a SolidWorks model. So when I did so, it imports a whole bunch of different components, I guess, but that's, for what we're doing, it's not super important that we merge all of those into one part or whatever. We'll go back to the main directory connectors. These are the rings that will hold the rocket together, not too dissimilar from what I think PSAS is using. Nose cone, just really basic stubby nose cone. And finally, business end. So we've got the butt end of the rocket with a aperture at the bottom for the engine. We've got a fin that'll somehow attach to the side of it. We've got a framework that will fit inside the butt end. And finally, we have the engine that obviously is very accurate as far as the kind of hardware that people are using these days for rocketry. So that being said, when you put it all together, you get something that looks a little something like this. So this was something that I kind of threw together on my own. And what we're looking at right now is the main branch of this creation. Like, this is something that hasn't been branched at all. This isn't something that anybody else has collaborated with on yet. So once I got this to this point, I went up to here where it says manage versions and history, clicked on that. And it was at this point right here, I created a new branch just called main assembly version 1. And then from there, I created a branch by right-clicking on it and saying branch to create new workspace. And I labeled that Hunter Changes branch. So I'm going to click on that now. Now what this does is it means that everything that I do in this branch is going to only affect anybody who is looking at this. And what you can, one of the things that you'll notice is that like on these main, or on this development, I don't know what you would call this, web branch pathway, whatever, you have filled in circles and open circles. The open circles indicate that this is a live workspace, that this is where things can be done, where changes can be made. And those changes are going to be shown in this dropdown right here. This will show any changes that have taken place since the previous branched workspace changes. So we can look at all of the changes that I made from when I started creating the rocket up until when I created this version. And so you have all of these and that, and Adam has also gone and from that exact same work point created a branch point, created his own version. And we're gonna go and take a look at that. So his version looks a little bit different than my version. Now, we were working on this independently, so what happens now? Well, I guess it kind of depends on how we want to develop this rocket, but one of the things that's, I guess, really cool about this is that anybody at any point right now can go back to the main assembly and they can look at the where it was, and they can also look at a potential future or another potential like way that we can do stuff. So this allows like different people in your group to go and test things out, play with development options without necessarily affecting what everybody else is working on. Adam, are you on this document right now?
I am on the main assembly, yes. So on my branch, yep.
Okay. So one of the things that we can do, I'm just looking to see if I can see you in here, is I can add comments to things. So yeah, I'm going to go back to the main branch as well. And so when you're working with people, you want to be able to showcase like, or you want to be able to communicate things that need to be changed. And so like, let's say we need to make sure that the color on this is changed because just, color is super important.
I just joined the main open workspace and I just popped up on your screen. I was like, why am I not on there? But because I was on my branch, I didn't show up on your screen, but now I went to the same branch that you're on and then I popped up.
I just noticed that. Yeah. So up here in the upper right hand corner, you can see that there's an A for Adam H, and that means that he is working there. Now, if I actually, that's something that's kind of cool. Yeah. If I double click on his.
That's me rotating it now.
Yep. My hands are free. So this is now Adam and me looking at what Adam is doing.
So that's now, exactly what I'm seeing on my screen.
That's really cool. One of the biggest advantages to doing branching workspaces when you have multiple people working on a document is if you all branch off of a main workspace, then you aren't stepping on each other's toes. Right now, both Adam and I are working on the exact same document. So Adam, let's go into the nose.
Okay.
So I'm going to click on nose here. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and change what I think this nose should look like. I think it needs to be even more drag inducing than normal. So now we're looking at some weird, I don't know, Russian ICBM type nose cone. Now, Adam, you should go and make the change that you want to make on this nose cone.
Okay, well, I am...
And I'm going to double-click on your thing just so that I can see what you're doing.
Okay, yeah, and you double-click to look at a screen, and then you can't like do anything with it. You're just watching their screen, so if you click anywhere again, you go out of that. But it leaves you looking at what they were looking at last, but now you're working back on your screen again once that colored border is gone. I am a pretend aerodynamicist and I like pointy nose cones. I'm going to call this like, oh wait, where'd it go? Sorry, I think I got distracted.
Does it matter that you're both on the main branch and not your individual branches right now?
It does. And what we're kind of showcasing right now is that this is how you can have people mess up while working together on the same document and why you would want to branch in the first place. So like, this is something that's cool that Onshape allows you to do. And if you are like in constant communication with each other, like Adam and I are right now, it's probably not that big of a deal. But if everybody's like in their own, home office working on something at whenever, all hours of the day, you want to make sure that you're not going to, mess with each other's like changes or whatever. So I've clicked out of Adam's workspace, so now I can look at it. And from my perspective, oh no, my stubby 2-inch height thing is now changed considerably, and that is not great. Like,
I was being stupid and trying to change that variable on the thing. By the way,
it's because I broke the variables effect on our sketch, so. It doesn't matter anyway. But yeah, so like if this was a situation where we were, where we wanted to produce this nose cone, we wanted to have it 3D printed or whatever the hell we're doing with this rocket. Adam just changed the main workspace that I had also just changed. And that is going to create a little bit of a conflict. And he might have changed it hours after I've already logged off, which means I didn't know that this has necessarily taken place. I don't know what all of the changes that he's made. Like, I can always go back into the versions in history and I can look at the changes that have been made recently. And I can actually click on any of those changes to see like exactly how that was, how that affected the final outcome of our design here. But in the end, like, this isn't a very efficient way to work. One of the more efficient ways to work is for us both to, as we said earlier, create our own individual branches, even just if we're going to work on it for like 30 minutes. But that's cool. All right. So we've all, or both Adam and I have created our own branches, but how do we get that back into the main workflow of this rocket? Like, we both want have something that we want to commit to the main the main page or the main development of this rocket. So that being said, at this point, Adam and I could communicate either through Zoom or text or whatever, Slack. Or we can also go in and create comments directly in Onshape and directly call out aspects of it. So I'm going to go into my branch and I'm going to add a comment referencing this nose cone right here. I'm going to say too short. And hold on, this in the way.
But by the way, something I discovered today, I'd never used comments before today. In that comment, there's the little kind of dotted box on the bottom right of the text box. Yeah,
the markup
box. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you can apparently like take a photo essentially and like draw arrows and stuff on it, and that photo will be in the comment.
And so now, when I add this,
there it is. Yeah. Okay.
There will be a little icon that shows up on this feature, and it will also, when you click on it, have this picture that we've just created in Onshape. We didn't have to export it and play with it in Photoshop or any of that stuff. Yeah, the annotations directly in. No, Kipton. Excuse me. the annotations directly in Onshape are like really helpful as far as being able to communicate like what you want to change and how. So I obviously this nose cone is too short. We would want to commit Adam's change to the main branch. However, I really like my color. So how would we navigate this? Well, remember before when I showed you that each of these, or when you click on the changes option under each of the branches, it shows you all of the different things that you've done, like including changing the part appearance, changing, you know, all of that fun stuff. Whenever you go and you commit one of these changes back into, or fold one of those branches back into the main development, what it will do is it will basically take all of those changes that you've just done that are being outlined right here and stack them on top of your existing changes on the main workflow. So let's take a look at what that actually looks like. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to try and put that branch back into the main workflow. Now, let's see what we can. This part I'm not super used to. Adam, do you know how to fold it back in?
Not really. Also, branching is something I've not dealt with much before.
You have to work backwards from the main branch. Sorry, I thought you would have to click on the one that you're wanting to fold in, but no, instead you go to our main branch right here and you'd say merge into current workspace, which I currently have selected my workspace. So what this does then is, let's just make sure that we have that. Show changes. This is something that I'm not super used to as far as like the merging of branches. Anybody who's played around more with GitHub would probably have a much better understanding than I do.
I could be wrong, but you may have to be in the branch that you want to merge to.
That makes a lot of sense.
You may have to be in the main branch and then select your branch to merge into the main.
That makes sense.
There's also a pretty good video on branching and merging that I watched earlier, although didn't obviously fully understand it yet, that I can put in the chat that explains it pretty well for no one to watch later. But hopefully we can figure this out here too.
I can imagine once this is sort of gone through in much deeper, in a much deeper dive than Adam and I have done in the last 2 hours, that it can definitely be rolled out in a much cleaner manner than what we're currently presenting. But like the video that Adam is referencing, which, have you posted that in the chat yet?
Not yet, I'm about to though.
Okay. That video does a much better job of explaining it, and it even shows you like the paths that you can take to do that. But this is, or like all of the different buttons that you need to press and the things to right click on. I just forgot exactly the way that it's supposed to be done, and I apologize for that. But more or less, like this allows you to go ahead and work better as a group as far as making sure that you're not losing information and that everybody gets their chance to make the changes that they want to make and then to merge those changes into the main assembly.
Okay, I've just put the video in the chat. I got it to the point where he starts talking about merging. Mm-hmm. It might be worth watching now, Katie. I don't know if you would want to do that. It's about like 6 minutes. He starts talking about merging about halfway through the video. I don't know, Kate, do you think that would be a good use of time?
Yeah, sure. Why not? If it's only, you know, like 6 minutes, we can all learn. So.
Okay. Yeah, I think that'll help me too, for sure.
I'll stop sharing my screen then, and if you want to share yours then.
Okay, cool. Got it. Remember how to zoom. No, I think I lost it right there. Okay, then we didn't zoom. I'm fortunate that I don't have to use Zoom very often, so I'm not good at it. Okay. Now, will audio work? I have no idea. Can you hear that?
Yeah, it's quiet, okay. But yeah.
How do you know when you won't break? What if there's a conflict? Which one will win? Does it matter whether it's a sketch feature or an extrude feature? Is there a tie? What happens if there is a tie? Well,
is it good enough to hear?
That left me feeling like I have to memorize a whole list of rules and if-thens in order to be able to predict what will happen when I merge.
I think it's okay as long as we turn our volume up.
For me, it's really just one thing.
Okay.
Remember that list of actions from the beginning of the video? Well, now that you're working in two branches, you have two lists of actions, one in the main branch and one in V1. When you merge one branch onto the other, you can think of it as taking one of the lists of actions and just stacking it on top of the other list, which is simply fine. The active workspace name in this case will end up on the bottom, and the one being pulled in goes on top. The result is identical to if you had never branched to begin with and just done everything you did in main, followed by everything you did in V1. Identical. Right, let me show you. Starting with the steps we did in main, we renamed the parts radio, changed the number of holes, and changed it green. The things we did in V1, we changed the part purple, changed the hole size, and imported the speaker component. The only conflict we had here was that we changed the part color 2 times. It ended up purple, which is exactly what we would expect when we changed the part to green and then changed it to purple. So what about if we merged the other way, from main into V1? The steps from main would stack on the steps from V1 like this. In V1, we changed the part purple, changed the hole size, and imported the speaker component. Next came the steps from main, in which we renamed the part studio, changed the number of holes, and changed the part to green. Again, color is the only conflict here, but since we changed it purple first and then green, it's going to stay green. All the other steps land us in the same place as before, since none of them overrode each other or caused each other to fail. Now, you might be thinking that even though you find this interesting, you're not sure if it's very useful. And I would argue that that's because I'm using an overly simplified example just to get the idea across and make it clear. Branching and merging like this becomes more and more valuable the less straightforward your project is and the more people that are working on it. I've seen a number of creative uses for branching and merging, but in
fact, that pretty much covers what we were going over there.
Yeah, I'm just trying to remember if there's anything useful after that, but
not really.
Okay. I will stop my sharing. So do you know if you have to? This is something my brain is totally frazzled today from earlier, but
I figured out what had happened before when I did my merge, and I can kind of explain that. So when I merged main with my workspace, what it did, if you'll remember, Adam, you went and changed that nose height to 16 inches.
Mm-hmm.
And so that stacked everything on top of my changes. So if we go back to here, we've got the insert feature. We changed the height from there. And then by kind of going through all of that, we were able to, or it then went and added your height change from 8 inches to 16 inches and added all of those changes from main onto my branch here. So let's take a look at what's currently in main and Adam's branch. I think we should try and merge Adam's branch onto main. And if we do this correctly, the only thing that should change is the color of the rocket in main, because Adam's is currently colored yellow, and the main branch has blue, this weird like eggshell blue. So what we want to do is bring this branch back into main. How do we do that? So we are currently selected on main, and then I'm right clicking on Adam's branch and I'm saying merge into current workspace. And now, yep, that's exactly how it worked. So whoever had mentioned it earlier that we needed to be in the main branch and merge into that workspace was absolutely correct. So now that we're in the main work branch, we can see that it's changed to yellow. And if we go to my workspace, it's still purple. If we go to Adam's workspace, we see that it's yellow. And that's awesome. And if we wanted to say, like, this is exactly what we want to do going forward, what we would do then is we would create a version that moves forward from here. So let's create a version. We'll call this main assembly. Whoa. V2. So now we've
real quick, as we get into more complex parts and assemblies too, there's actually a notes section as well. So keeping track of the changes made between versions would also be a good idea.
Absolutely. I think you can actively change the notes or the description of what's going on in any individual workspace. We could go back to main here and look at the properties and description. Yeah, just whatever we wanted to say, like this is exactly what this was supposed to be, is the rocket. Whoa, sorry, I'm really bad at typing and looking at the screen at the same time. So apply, close. And now whenever somebody checks out the properties on this, it will have that information. But looking at anything else here, it doesn't have that information. So, or the notes as far as like what's being changed. And if I was to go into my workspace here, I could say, I made it purple. And now anybody who's viewing all of the changes and branches and stuff could easily see like what the main change was in a given branch or plot line. So yeah. Does anybody have any like questions or thoughts on this? I know that we're not exactly the perfect resource to go to for a lot of this, but we can try and work through it together. And I think that's one of the kind of interesting things that Onshape really allows for, is working through stuff together.
Yeah, we've both figured out pretty much all this stuff today. So I think it's useful. I think I'm going to start using some of the features in it too.
I have a couple just like extraneous things. We have a bunch of people who are switching over to Onshape from SolidWorks. Mm-hmm. And so going into your personal settings, you can change your mouse macros to match those of SolidWorks. So you still have like your right click, middle click, all those functions be the same just for orienting your part a little bit easier. And then one thing which is a little bit more of a novelty, but is really helpful if you use an iPad, is there is an iOS app for Onshape, which you can technically do all your CAD there. It's pretty much useless except for showing off what you made on the iPhone. But if you do use an iPad, you're actually able to do CAD through there as well.
There's also an app for the Android operating system, and I've done a few changes on the fly while using it. It's really like it's not super user friendly because you don't have a keyboard or a mouse for moving stuff, but they've built the app in such a way that it allows you to select an individual thing, change an individual parameter, apply that parameter, and go from there without having access to all of the tools on your screen simultaneously, because that would get extremely like busy with very little workspace. So I've used it for that. And it's also, yeah, as you said, extremely useful for just kind of showcasing your idea or concept to somebody on the fly. Like if you're meeting up with friends and they're like, hey, what are you working on? And I'm like, hey, I'm working on this rocket. Like you can show them in 3D exactly what that looks like. So yeah, good to know that they have the ability to change the mapping on the mouse, though. I wasn't aware of that. And as somebody who started working in SolidWorks with parametric 3D modeling, I can imagine that would have been really useful when I first started working with Onshape. But since then, I've actually worked more with Onshape than I have in SolidWorks. And so I'm used to kind of the UI interface of this platform now.
Yeah, and I've worked in Onshape a lot in the last couple of years. I never really got into SolidWorks because it just didn't seem very user-friendly to me. So I've done a lot of modeling, and Hunter certainly has too, a lot more than me even, in Onshape. So if we want to do like another one of these meetings or something, I can go through someone coming from SolidWorks and tell them how I would do it in Onshape. I was kind of thinking maybe it'd be a good idea to make an Onshape Slack channel for like questions and maybe some demos and things.
Yeah, that'd probably be a good idea.
And then something else I saw today that I've only started kind of playing with, and I think it works, is you can make a version from like the middle of like the list of changes in a version. Maybe you should try that and just see A, if it works, and B, if it seems useful.
Yeah, I'll stop sharing my screen and we can take a look at yours.
Okay. Let me try to set up a good kind of a demo of this. I have a bunch of versions, but they have so few changes in them. Okay, I'll just share my screen and then figure out where I'm going.
We're kind of Wallace and Gromit laying the track in front of the train as we're going along.
Yeah, very much so. Okay, so I'm here. I'll go back to my branch just to be me. Maybe I'll even do this. So
now with old versions like this, when you've created that branch from this, like where you just clicked right now, this old version, this version is locked now.
Right.
Nothing can be changed from this.
Yeah. So if there's a solid dot next to it, that's a made closed version. You can only like look at it and reference it. It's kind of locked in time for, I mean, it's a good thing for safety, so you can't mess it up. But you can, if you want to, you can obviously make a new version from this and start working from here again, but this stays locked in. Let me figure out what I want to do here. Click on this, what happens? Also, after you did so, no. I'm trying to come up with a good, it might even be a better idea to
do a change part appearance part 13.
Okay. Down here?
Yeah, that would be.
So it was blue and then, maybe it's not this. Oh, because these are changes for the entire document, right? So yeah. I have to go to camera bay. That's what I need to do. Right. Is it main face large or?
Yeah, it'll be under there.
Okay. So, go to here. And it's not. Here it's clear. Okay. So, if I wanted to start working on a version from here before this change, I can create version here, call it for clear or something. And it's four. Oh, okay. Because this version was made in a kind of pre-version of main assembly v1. It's showing up before that, and it's not clear yet. And
one of the reasons why you might want to do that is if you wanted to do a if you wanted to compare things, which is something that you can actually do. You can compare different branches. So I think if you right click on before clear,
I'm trying to do a compare. Oh, is this the
compare? Oh yeah, there it is. That's the button.
Yeah. Oh, this is a really cool feature. I think I know you. We did the demo of it back when we talked at PSU, but I don't know if people have seen it since then. So,
so if you click on that one and then the main assembly,
yeah,
it'll show the differences between the two.
So both versions are overlaid together here, and then this little slider in the top. You can. This is not the best example of this, but you can see, you can like kind of morph between the two versions. Like if something is a different size, it's like a really good difference, or if you, there are only tiny changes in something and you had to figure out what they were. Yeah, just click on two versions and the little kind of two arrow button on the top and you can see what the changes were. Let's get out of here.
Yeah, like doing that comparison between, say, Adam's branch and the original main would kind of showcase like the difference in the color, or comparing my change or my branch to the main would change the, you would be able to see the change in the shape of the nose cone.
Oh, that'd be a good better thing to do. I can do. This just to let's do that just for fun. Go to nose and we'll compare these two. They're actually different. They are not, because we merged them, didn't we? That was great.
I suppose so, yeah. I kind of shot myself in the foot there by doing that merge, and unfortunately I don't think there's a way to undo a merge.
No, but I can reference a previous thing. If I can figure out how to get the hell out of here. I don't know. I'll just go to... No, I'm blanking. Okay, yes, I'll go to this branch, and then... we'll do start, and... Start in mine.
Well, start is... There's nothing there.
Oh, it's the very start, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, it's just... Anyway, I'll do this one and mine. And we'll do here, nose. Ah, there we go. Okay, that's a better example.
Much so better.
It's the main assembly, the earlier version, and then going on to mine, you can see pretty obvious change here. Even overlay them so they're transparently with each other. I haven't thought of a use for this, but I'm sure there are some, which is kind of a neat thing.
Okay, so I have questions. My gears are turning, and it's okay if you don't have answers, because I think some of this might be, I just need to like go through and do it myself, but when you were originally like trying to merge the branches, so let's say that like, yeah, one person like Adam has orange nose cone and it's short, and you have tall nose cone and it's purple, and we want it to be short and purple in main. So like, how do we just pick out like the specific things that we want to merge into main?
That's a good question. The way that this is set up is there is no way to select individual features to merge into, or from one branch into another branch, if you will. You can't do individual features. That's why if you're working on incremental changes, doing so by grabbing one of the, sorry, there's somebody on the phone. if you're able to grab, or when you're doing incremental changes, you only want to do like maybe a few things and then merge it back in, as opposed to building an entirely new rocket. And then it's like, oh, but I only wanted to change the nose cone on it. Like, that's why doing like often branching and re-merging them is going to give you a better workflow as a collaborative group effort.
Okay, that's fair. And then I guess that brings me to my next question. So I guess it's just human nature where for some reason we want to like work on a part, but we aren't sure if we want to like save it. And so I think we just like to like go in and like see what happens if we change things. So like, what do you think is the best way to like, if someone just wants to go in and change our nose cone to like square just for fun, is there like a way for them to just kind of see it and then be able to just like get rid of it? Like, should they make like a new, like, I don't know what the words are, but make like a new one that they can delete when they're done?
Or absolutely
a new branch, right?
We can approach that from a myriad of different ways, but doing a new branch and just calling it like square nose cone branch, or Hunter's square nose cone branch, and actually like let's just do that live. Let me share my screen.
I have a quick question. So is there an upside to making a new branch rather than making a duplicate of the part studio and then messing with it that way?
You can of course do a duplicate that way. There's no reason not to do that, but if you're planning on ever getting that change committed back to the main part studio, you don't want to have a bunch of like weird duplicate, like not usable parts in your main workspace kind of down here. So yeah, let's go off of the, whoop, here we go. Adam's branch. Which one is the main one? This is the one that we've committed to right now. So I'm going to go ahead and create a branch from here. Somehow.
Can you branch from a branch, or do you have to branch from main?
Oh, I would have to go from the previous workspace here. So main assembly, and branch from that. And we'll just call this. So now we've got this new weird one, and I can go in and adjust. Like, this is something that I'm just going to use to play around with a new shape. So I'm going to go ahead and delete that and then create a new sketch. This is going to look really like goofy, but we'll just do it for fun. Why not? So we'll select that and this and change that to -14. Perfect.
Also, does SolidWorks have something like mate connectors? Because I use them all the time in Onshape, but I don't know if SolidWorks does.
SolidWorks, to my knowledge, does not have mate connectors. Like, you have to select three individual things and kind of go from there.
Yeah, they're really useful. I can do a little demo of those later if people want to.
Yes. Because I don't know what that is.
It sounds cool.
It's super useful, and like, if we wanted to, we could go and do an entire like session about like how to use mate connectors effectively, especially when you're creating an assembly. But I don't want to like talk everybody's ear off right now about it, just because like it can get kind of heady. So
maybe do like a little mini demo about putting a mate connector like in the middle of the upper surface of that ring, just kind of as a tiny thing.
It's super useful unless you want to glue something to the side of a round surface. That mate connectors are great. And then we had a huge problem trying to get the fins attached to the fin can because they're at like an arbitrary point on the side of a curved surface, and it made it really strange. But in general, mate connectors are really nice.
Yeah, I mean, like with most things in 3D modeling, it's all about how you basically go ahead and set yourself up for what you want to do in the future. Like if you wanted to be able to attach a fin to the side of a rocket or whatever, like having a feature that allows you to reference that with a mate connector would like allow you to put it where you want it exactly without having to worry too much about it otherwise. I often use bolt holes as reference points for putting parts together in an assembly. But yeah, that's something maybe for another time. Oops, edit. I wanted to put the nose and that together. Very good. Yep, so here's my really inefficient nose cone now. And I just was playing around with that. This is in my square nose cone area. I'm done with this. I don't want to commit this to anything. So if I wanted to, I can go and just delete this branch. Now, keep in mind, when I hit delete, there's no going back from that. And this data is lost forever. So that's something that like you can get rid of a branch that you were just kind of futzing around with. But it also kind of comes with like a permanent cost. Yeah, see, like it'll warn you saying, are you sure this is something you want to do? And now we don't ever have to worry about that square nose cone ever coming up in any of our future development. Whereas if I was to go and create a duplicate of the workspace, as you had mentioned before, like I could go into, let's return to Adam's branch. I could go and create a duplicate nose cone copy and go and do all of that square nose cone business that I had just done in the test branch. But now there would be a nose cone copy one in the main branch, and that wouldn't be useful for anybody because it's an unuseful part.
But if you had made a new branch, done your experimentation, and then versioned it, then you couldn't delete that version, right? You can only delete an open workspace, right?
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
No. So if you'd made the experimental branch, because it was still open and you hadn't versioned anything on that branch, you could still delete the whole branch. But if you had made a version on that branch with the closed dot on it, then you could not delete that version. And so that extra experimentation branch would always be there, right?
Yeah, like because you created that before clear workspace or that version down here,
that one's always there too.
That will always be there in our design workflow. So I can't get rid of that. So
what is the benefit of having those, like the versions that makes the closed dot rather than just leaving it open?
Basically, that's when you're committing to a given design element to a certain extent. Like when I made that, I referenced it as version one and version two. So if you're in like the main design workflow saying this rocket right here, this is what we are committing to before we prototype this. And whenever you decide to make those different workspaces, really kind of depend or make those commitments to new versions, depends on how you're utilizing this information. So like say you are going to 3D print one of the fins and do some testing on it, you might want to make a version and say that, or right before you 3D print that fin and say, this fin is definitively version one. And then you go and you print off that fin, do your tests, and then make those changes. And then those changes would be in a new version that you would now call version two. And you can go on then through that in that manner. So basically, if you're approaching this from a part-by-part basis, you would have probably a lot of different versions, whereas like the entire rocket assembly probably wouldn't have a whole bunch of different versions because you're only going to build like one main rocket before testing it.
And the new version is essentially like a Git commit, at least in my mind. Like I do at least one version every work session. You definitely should. I do one after like every kind of major change I make to a part, even if I'm not sure about it or not, it's there at least, and it can always kind of revert and change it.
Continue, Adam. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
That's pretty much it, JP. that like do versions all the time. I've got like 30 different versions of the pass-through components document I was working on. I don't think there's any real reason not to do version kind of whenever you think about it, at least.
I think PSAS people don't like to commit to things, so.
Yeah.
So one more thing about versions is if you have an assembly, you can't import changes that haven't already been made in a version. So if you make a bunch of changes to a part in an assembly, nothing will change until you make a version and update that part in the assembly to the new version.
Yes. I think
so you can completely break an entire part, and if you don't make a change, if you don't create a version, nothing will change in the assembly.
I don't really get that, but that's okay.
Because assembly will only work from committed versioned parts. Is that what you're saying, JP?
Yeah. Can I share my screen for 2 seconds?
Yeah, let me stop my share.
Let's do this. We're going to go into some random thing.
Super Aero Rocket right there.
Yeah, right. So if I go into this and so we're currently on V7. If I is this even the right thing? Oh, this isn't even the right thing. But how can I suppress? So I'm not in main right now. So if I'm in the tank, this is all broken, right? So this part isn't even correct right now. But if I go back to the main assembly, this is correct and the assembly is also correct because those changes, nobody made a version of those changes. And so the assembly will never update if a new version isn't made. And that's what this icon is. It's saying there's changes or there's a new version that isn't part of this assembly.
Okay, so you've changed a part without making a version of it, but the assembly is still using the versioned parts, but it knows there's a new one and it's saying, hey, this isn't the new one.
Yeah, this is saying this is not the new one. And so if there's changes, it'll give you a prompt to, it will create a new version and import that new version as well. So if you have an assembly and you make changes without making a version, you will never see that in the assembly.
Cool.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense now. Okay, interesting.
So yeah, assemblies only include version parts basically.
But did that happen because there you had them in different like folders rather than with Hunter and Adam's part? It was all in one like workspace.
No, yeah, he had everything in assembly versus a individual parts in a workspace.
Would you share your screen again, Hunter?
Yeah, I can do that.
And so you have an assembly in main.
Right, and I have that listed as main assembly. So these are all of the parts that we've created in individual part documents, basically. So like under main fuselage, we have the 8-inch tube and whatnot. And so we can see that here, and that's that 8-inch tube right there.
So yes, actually, Katie, you're correct. Because when you make a version, you're making a version of this entire collab test doc. When you make a version, it makes a version of every single folder in that file. So the reason that it's not updated is because it's in a separate file. Yes.
Yeah, versions are the entire document.
Right, okay. So depending on what we're trying to get out of it, we could do it Hunter's way or the way that we have it now where they're completely separate, like docs or workspaces or whatever you call them.
Yeah, and, okay. And it'll probably end up being somewhere in the middle where we'll have larger subsystems that are versioned differently. Like the propulsion system and the airframe, once we do have CAD, will probably end up being in different folders. So if there's an update to the airframe, then we'll have this like one blue circle, which is like, okay, the entire airframe needs to change, or the plumbing diagram needs to change.
Right. So like airframe, we would do it Hunter's way, and then we would just be in our own folder of like LV4 airframe or whatever, and then you would have your own.
Yeah, and then once we had a full assembly, we would combine those two folders into like a full rocket assembly.
Okay, I like that. Okay.
Yeah, I was gonna ask/point out, it seems that if you had an assembly that used an assembly that was a separate document and did like that nesting process a couple of times, it could potentially be pretty annoying if you were trying to tweak some like low level part in the context of a larger assembly, because it would be creating versions for all of these documents.
Yeah. Like our,
but I think
our pasture ring alone has like 27 immersions in Onshape right now.
Right.
And then that's assembly, which is then part of an assembly, and you have to reversion everything on the way up.
Yeah, it seems like what we've been doing in Onshape is kind of a weird version control strategy.
Yes,
it works.
We learned
having everything.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Like in. Maybe this is what you were about to say, that in SolidWorks, we learned to make everything separate documents so that we could have version control at a finer level. But then commits applied at like the project level. So we had, you know, a repo for the airframe and a repo for recovery and a repo for cameras, because those were like big distinctions we could draw between projects.
Yeah.
But here we've got those version control boundaries at a lower level than they should be.
Yeah. And I think, well, so the main point was, is when we first started using Onshape, the focus was, can we do the things that we did in SolidWorks and Onshape? And so
right.
That was the main focus, is can we physically do all the CAD parts? And I think a lot less focus was put on how do we properly version control within Onshape.
Yeah.
And so yeah. There is one thing which is nice if you have a bunch of unsaved changes. Hunter, would you go to the main assembly?
Absolutely. Sorry, just coloring things.
I do love your engine, by the way.
That pale blue restart symbol almost right below the Onshape logo. So if you have documents in other folders, which are part of it, that will be a brighter blue, and you can click that and then just reversion everything in the assembly at once. That's one thing.
I'm curious if that'll show up on
this. No, everything's in the same folder right now.
Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Sorry.
So like I could show you, but I would break this. Well, you guys are making your own assembly, so it doesn't really matter, but.
I'm assuming that only like fast forwards on whatever branch it's tracking. It won't like jump branches when you do that.
So the parts that are taken from the theoretical branch, because right now we've been doing everything in the main branch. So this is saying the part that you put in there are changes, and there could be a new version, and it'll update all the versions at once. If I could share my screen real quick, I'm not going to update it because I don't want to break everything. So looking at this assembly, this is a darker blue. And then if I click it, it'll show you everything that has changes, and it'll create a new version with those changes and update everything. Whereas this one, a version has already been made, but for these two, there are changes that haven't been saved to a version yet, which it will create a version and then update.
Okay.
That makes sense. Yeah.
And Katie, what did you think of my pass-through component document, kind of part studio organization thing? Is that worth showing people?
Your what?
the camera mount document that I sent you to look at. Do you think that's like just kind of showing people that you can make a whole subassembly in one part studio and the parts will be separate in the studio?
Oh. Yes, that. Yes, show them.
Okay, cool. I will share my screen. And I definitely don't know if this is the best organizational way to do this, but for some things it certainly probably can be. These are the camera mounts I made for the pass-through ring. And this is, so I have a separate part studio for each kind of sub-assembly. I have the camera ring derived from, or you can import it as well from the camera ring document. So it's just a solid, uneditable part in this. And then from here, I started building the camera mount. So I imported, well, actually I made the camera itself, if I can find that. It's been a while since I've worked on this. Imported the camera and then, not that. Where'd it go? There. And then just started working on multiple parts within this part studio, and all the parts are just down here, and you can hide and do whatever you want to them there. I like doing it this way, just editing in situ, because all the parts are there. Assemblies are a bit confusing to me. And I think as long as, at least in my mind, if you just have a thing that doesn't have any moving parts, it's probably at least useful to do to make that just in one part studio. Might be simpler that way, but you can do that anyway. And you can, most of the features you make, like if you wanted to do an extrude on here, you can say, let me just do this for an example. Where's it going? I'll do this. So extrude this, and here it defaults to new. You can also do add to make it an extension of that same part. But if I do new and 25 millimeter extension or extrusion on that, that is now a separate part. So that part 20 now, and I can make that disappear. That's how I, I think that's fairly self-explanatory. And then, this is a pretty good example of a mate connectors. I'll just very briefly talk about this. So I've got these screws that I've imported from McMaster Car. That I have these referenced to a mate connector, which it has been a while, but I think, okay. So I have a mate connector on this hole. I'll do it on this hole just as an example, because there's not one there yet. So mate connector will have to be a little bit careful with it, but it will find the middle of any circle or even the middle of a cylinder. And if I go there, it kind of gives you the bottom, middle, and top of this countersink. So I can put it there in this new mate connector and accept. And then if I wanted to transform this screw and copy it by mate connectors, I'll say from mate connector, that one, or you can even just click on the circle, and then to mate connector, that one there, copy, and it pops in. You can do that if you want to lay parts on top of each other. You just like select, put a mate connector. You can just place a mate connector using this mate connector tool, and it just puts it there permanently unless you delete it. Or if you're doing something, an operation like a transform, you can select by mate connector and then select the to and from. Or even if I wanted to you can use them to define features as well. Like if I wanted to make a sketch on, say, I want it to be on the face of this hole here, I could, it's asking for a sketch plane, but you can also tell it to look for a mate connector by clicking that there, and I can put it on the face of this countersink. You have to try a little bit there. That's the front of that countersink. And now there's a sketch plane on the front of that countersink hole. Anyway, that's a brief little look at how they work.
The mate connectors are... I was just going to say the mate connectors are super useful far as being able to locate things in space, copy and paste objects over, or just translate things within your workspace, because a mate connector includes 3 points of reference, basically. Like it has, it's a, like as you saw on Adam's screen, it's a triad. It has the X, Y, and Z, and an origin point. And like, if you were to try and locate something in SolidWorks, you would have to reference at least 3 different things in order to kind of get stuff to sit where you want it to. Say like putting a screw into a countersunk hole, you would have to do a cylindrical mate. You would have to do a planar mate to get the top of the screw down there. And if you wanted it to be in a very specific orientation, you'd have to do an angled mate. So like, there's a lot of different things that would factor into that. Whereas a mate connector allows you to do all of those things simultaneously. And because it's using the geometry itself to kind of like figure out where that origin point and where those planes are going to be, you can adjust that with really high precision and with only a few clicks, whereas before it would take, you know, multiple different operations. So it's super useful. I can attest to that.
And mate connectors are also how assemblies get put together. So you can install essentially a mate connector onto a part and then have another mate connector on another part. And then when you go to put them in assembly, they'll just put mate to mate. And
you don't even need to add a mate connector like you did. You can if you want, but you don't necessarily have to, because most of the operations that would use a mate connector, such as the translate or create a sketch operation, already have a little option right next to that input box that has a little mate connector symbol. And by clicking on that, you can make a reference directly to the geometry that's already on screen without having to go and create a new mate connector from scratch. But you'll always have the ability to adjust those mate connector parameters, such as, you know, if you wanted to have it float off of the surface of something or whatever, or translate it or rotate it, you can do that without having to add one.
Yeah, you can also change the orientation of a mate connector, well, at least a mate connector that you've like deliberately placed there using the mate connector tool. You can go in and edit the mate connector and change its orientation or even position as well.
Yep.
They're handy. So yeah, you can either place them using the tool or just kind of like infer them within a, while you're making a feature. Is infer the right word? Something like that.
Sure, we'll go with that.
I think you get what I mean. Does anyone think of anything else to talk about? Any questions or ideas?
I think, I mean, I'm good, unless anybody else has any other questions, but I think this was really good, and I think we have some discussion to do on how we want to organize things, but yeah, I think this was really helpful. I learned a lot, so okay. Thank you guys.
Yeah, I'm really interested to see what you do going forward and how you, what kind of rules and procedures you come up with.
I'm glad to hear that despite my best efforts, you managed to actually learn something from this. So yeah, no, that's good to hear. And if you have any questions about all of this, I can put my contact info in the chat here.
Oh, I added Hunter to our Slack.
And I'm also on the Slack too, I guess.
Yeah. And if you, I don't know if you can do it, or pester Andrew to make a, if you want to make a an Onshape Slack channel.
I'll bug him.
Talk about it in there.
Cool. Also, I want to ask too, like as our teams kind of get going, we might develop
lists of questions that we may want to ask you. So maybe in the future, coming up, maybe we could do another one of these if we have actual questions for you. I don't know if that's something you'd be...
Yeah, I'm down for that.
...into? Okay. Awesome. Because like right now, I don't quite know what to ask, and most of our team wasn't able to attend. So I imagine there's going to be more questions about how to proceed.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Definitely. How much of, Katie, how much have y'all been using Onshape so far? I'm not actually aware of how much you've done with it.
As a capstone team, none. Okay. Basically, what happened was last week we decided to use Onshape, literally a week from today. And then Andrew said, okay, let's meet next week and talk about Onshape. And then he's not even here. And
as usual. Have you been using it with other teams and projects yet?
I haven't used it. I had my capstone team make Legos before today so that could get the tools down, and I don't know how that went for them, but
I might be the only person on our team that's used it already.
Okay, cool. I'm glad you've got some experience in it.
Not much, but a little.
No, good. Yeah, one of the things that I was hopeful that it would be reasonably easy for PSAS people to pick up is because it's in a lot of ways pretty similar to SolidWorks. So at least it's got some kind of basis with it. I think it's a lot easier to use than SolidWorks. Then again, I never actually learned to use SolidWorks because it looks so not friendly to me.
I can confirm having worked with the SolidWorks and Onshape that it works pretty well. That Onshape is a lot more user friendly from somebody just starting out. Like, you don't actually have to take a college course in it to be able to use the vast majority of the features that are available.
Yeah, I figured it out entirely like within the last year, and I've done modeling before, but never really, like I said, got into SolidWorks. So I learned parametric modeling with Onshape. And I'm sure there's some things that it can't do that we'll probably have to turn on SolidWorks again to do. That'll get a little bit complicated, but you can always make a part in SolidWorks and then bring it into Onshape, but then you can't, well, it would be at least hard to edit it once you get it into Onshape. But I probably only for really complex geometry might you need to do that, but I haven't found anything that is impossible to do in SolidWorks like this. I'll show my screen again real quick. On this camera mount here, this kind of swoopy aerodynamic shape was done with lofts, and it was a bit of a pain, but I eventually got it to be exactly what I wanted. And I don't know if that would be any easier in SolidWorks.
So I got Andrew on to talk about organizing for LV4 stuff. I don't know, Andrew, if you have questions for our Onshape experts, even though they would disagree, but Hunter and Adam, otherwise you guys can stay on if you want to have an opinion, but I don't want to make you sit through Andrew arguing with us. So
yeah, they suck. You don't want to listen. Hi, Hunter. Thanks for coming on. And hi, Adam.
Hello. I'm glad you enjoyed our entire presentation, Andrew.
Yeah, it was really good. I wasn't invited to this one until later, so that at least it's being recorded.
Andrew, this was your idea.
Yeah, you set up this meeting.
You put it in the calendar.
I knew that. Yep, I was just testing you. I had no idea. I'm sorry. This is the problem with having a real job.
Jobs suck.
Well, at least I can go back and
and watch it.
Watch it, yeah. Are you going to post this to YouTube, or are you going to just have it locally?
I don't know. Do you guys want this posted on YouTube, or would you just rather me keep it in the Google Drive?
Doesn't bother me either way.
I have no objections to it being posted publicly or whatever, so take that as you will.
Cool. Okay. I'm going to stop it now then.
All right. Awesome.